everyone. Well, we might make a start. My name is Rebecca Tremaine. I'm the Organisational Development Advisor here in HR at the Uni, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all here today. So you're obviously here to be provided with the sorts of information that will help you in your applications for Level B and C under the promotions procedure at the University. Before we kick off, I'll just run through a little bit of housekeeping. So toilets are located back in the direction you came, down the very end of the passageway. Fire exits are located in the four corners of the building. So if needs be, I just suggest that you follow the crowds downstairs and to the assembly point on North Terrace opposite the War Memorial. So today's session will go for around 2.5 hours. If you've brought your lunch with you, please feel free to eat it during the session. Otherwise, we've got tea and coffee and some biscuits up the back and water for you to help yourself too. There's also a sign-in sheet here at the front. So if you haven't already done so, if you could just make sure that you sign your name before you leave today. And if you've got a mobile phone that's on, could you please make sure it's switched to silent for the duration of the workshop as we're filming here today. So to give you a brief overview of the people who will be speaking to you today, we have Professor Jenny Shaw, Executive Dean of the Faculty of Arts. Professor Shaw will provide you with information from the perspective of the promotions panel. We'll then have Professor Philippa Levy, Pro Vice Chancellor of Student Learning, who will speak to you about teaching matters. Then we have Professor Julie Owens, Pro Vice Chancellor Research Strategy, who will talk to you about presenting your research in a promotion application. To give you some insights from a successful applicant, you will hear from Dr. Claudia Szabo, Associate Dean, Diversity and Inclusion in ECMS. And finally, Jane Welch, Associate Director, HR Advisory, and Lisa Van Ruth, who is the University's Academic Promotions Officer, will speak to you about the process to apply for a promotion. I'll also just mention that there will be time for questions after each presentation, and we'll also take a break about halfway through the presentation today. So I will now hand over to Professor Shaw for today's first presentation.
Okay, thank you everyone, welcome. Some of you I know, some of you don't, so as Beck said, I'm Jenny Shaw, please call me Jenny, and I'm happy to take questions through. It's why I asked about the time. I'll keep a bit of an eye on it as well. But if you have a burning question, just wave at me madly and we'll answer it as we go through. Otherwise, take a note of something that you want to ask and we can take some questions at the end. And again, this is the perspective that I have as a panel member. So I chair the Level BC panels in Faculty of Arts and I sit on the university-wide panel for promotions to Levels D and E. But I've also sat on promotions committees at several other universities in this country. So my perspective is focused on this university and our current policy, but with a wider perspective from my experience. I've also tried to make this a little bit interesting, so I hope it doesn't drive you crazy. We'll see. All right. Recent stats. Again, it's always good just to know what your chances are. And you'll see there are some years where we have lots of successes, some years where it's a bit down. Always good to focus on the last year, 2016. As you can see, success rates for A's going to B's and B's to C's. Do we have anyone who's thinking of A going to B, or is it all B's going to C's in the room? No, we have some A's going to B? Okay, great. Okay, so it's pitched at both of you, both groups. But as you can see, success rates are really pretty good. Sometimes when we've had very small numbers, as in 2015 in our Level B males, it's really hard to make anything of that kind of proportion. So just keep in mind, sometimes the figures are too small to be really make any sense to us. Okay, my focus is going to be really on what the faculty committees will want from you, okay, when you're going at these levels. So it is a genre. That's really important to know. It's your choice about making a promotion case or not, but you have to write as if you're writing for a particular newspaper article or a particular type of scientific paper. It's a genre. So you need to just be aware of that. Know your audience, all right? So your committee and your faculty are not going to be people from your department. There may be, there may not be anyone from your department, but you're writing in some sense for educated generalists. So just pitch it that way. They actually need to know what you do when you're teaching any research. Know your current promotions procedure. That's really important, especially if you're having a second or a third go, because the promotions procedure changes a little bit every year, and sometimes those little changes are actually quite substantially different in the way you need to present your application. They can make quite a big difference to you. So just be aware that In the future, some of you may be asked to be on promotions panels. It's a big ask. We don't like reading applications that have been thrown together and clearly last minute. So again, just out of courtesy to your peers, try and prepare. If you're not prepared, consider putting it in the next year, right? We also don't want to fill in blanks. We are supposed to go on what is in front of us, not about what we know of you outside that folder of paper or emailed file, okay? So we really need to have the full story that you want to tell. This is your story, so what you want us to know needs to be in that application. Right. Also important to note, promotions at this university are always merit-based. We don't have quotas. We don't say, oh, it's only 5 level A's this year. And I think you'll get that from the numbers you saw. It really varies widely from, when we're saying, this time we had 60 people go, last year it might have been 10. It's up to you as an individual and that discussion you have with your supervisor about when you're going. It's based on demonstrated performance. It's not the things you've signed contracts for that are coming in the future, right? That's really important. It's actually, this is the article that's out. This is the teaching I've done. These are my results. We really can't go on stuff that's in the future with a little bit of leeway. We will look at the fact, for example, that you have an accepted book contract, for instance. But again, it's on demonstrated past performance, right? So we have the categories, of course, we look at teaching and HDR supervision, research and creative practice, and administration and service to the university, of course, professional service. We value them all, as you know, from the academic role statements. I think that now makes that very clear. Again, in the past, people would say, oh, you have to be a fantastic researcher to get promoted. That's absolutely not the case. But you have to be strong in a couple of areas. All right. We also treat faculties and schools equally in terms of the level of what needs to be demonstrated. So you need to show that you're performing at the level to which you are applying for promotion, whether it's in engineering or whether it's in music, okay? But the details will always vary. And this is where the peer committees in your faculties often have very different jobs to do in terms of assessing your promotion applications. Okay, so these are what we expect of our promotion committees, and certainly I do when I chair. We expect it to be a transparent process and we expect it to be an equitable one. And we have an HR observer at those meetings, and really HR's job at those meetings is often primarily, I think, to make sure that those processes are followed. Okay. The committees make a recommendation to the Executive Dean to promote or not promote each individual. Right? That's the job of those committees. And it's a myth to say, they're always looking for reasons not to promote people. That's absolutely not the case. Promotions committees are looking to promote you. They're not looking to pick holes in your case, right? So they want to see you get promoted. And they're not experts. So it's always good if you can presented a strong case. So that strong case will be evidence to your head of school, who then says in the head of school letter, I've seen the evidence, such and such, okay? Or if you've can fit it in the page limit and the additional papers, you've actually managed to put it in there. We also know that you have different strengths. So I think, again, now that we have very clearly research-focused staff, we have education specialists, we have scholarly teaching fellows, we will expect, sometimes because of your title or your designation, if you're an education specialist, we would expect to see some fantastic teaching. We would not necessarily expect to see fantastic research, although often the two go hand in hand. So you are going to be pitching that case to us, all right? The other thing we try and make sure is all the committees are at least gender represented. I know that's harder. And again, if we look at ECMS, it's harder. But also that we now have education specialists on the committees. And I also make sure on my committee we have at least one research-focused staff member. So there's always going to be somebody who's, they'll be at a high level, they'll usually be D's and E's. I usually use a senior lecturer now as well. But they will be someone with a mix that's not unlike yours, okay? The other thing is, please tell us a good story. It's your story and it's the story that the committee members want to hear. So it's actually a narrative you're writing, okay? And also, if you don't get promoted, it's not easy to get promoted. Even sometimes people clearly have done all the stuff, but they've not put it together the right way. If you don't get promoted, I'd say don't get discouraged. I know it is kind of a bit deflating. Take the criticism on board. And usually it's my role as chair of the committee for my faculty to be giving that feedback back for unsuccessful applicants. Take it on board because the feedback's intended to be constructive. All right? We're trying to say next time you go, it might be next year, might be in 2 years' time, this is what you need to fix, or this is what we didn't understand. Yeah. All right, so what do we want to see? We've all got gaps, we've all got holes, we've all got weaknesses. It's very rarely a promotion application that's absolutely perfect, or to be scoring 10 across the board, which is really rare. So what we want to see is that sustained performance. It's not just a flash in the pan where nothing's happened for 2 years and suddenly a lot of activity. We'll always be suspicious about that, okay? We want to see a kind of an upwards trajectory, all right? So that there's a clear path for where your teaching's going, there's a clear path for where your research is going, and that the service isn't just 6 months before the application goes in. So that's what we need to see, okay? So again, you might have a one-off of something, but often committees will be a little bit suspicious about that. Oh, now this person's done no work in the department and suddenly they're taking on library liaison. Looks a bit iffy. So just be aware of that. And again, if you've been on committees for the university, when you've finished the year or finished the service on that committee, it's always good to ask the chair for a letter or an email just acknowledging your service, because it's not that you sat on something, we'll come back to that, it's what you did in that role. And often the chair will be able to say what you did in a particular role that was useful. Okay. If you do have gaps, tell us what they are. Often people don't want to say what the gaps are. Promotion applications are confidential to the committee and you have to trust your peers. So if you have gaps, it might have been illness because of you, family member, it might have been you changed discipline areas, this does happen, you had to restart a lab. These things happen, we need to know. Now, each faculty handles these a bit differently, so my discussion is based around what we do in arts. But what I do, and I know this is done at the level DE levels as well, once I've chosen my committee and they've agreed to serve, once we get the promotion applications in, I assign each of them one or two to present. Depends on the numbers we have coming in. And they will be ideally applicants not in their department, not even in their school if I can help it, people they don't know. It's actually quite hard to present on someone you do know because other staff, it's hard to keep out the other stuff you know. So it's much easier if it's somebody who said, well, actually, I don't know this person, but here's what I can say about their teaching case, their research case, their service and their professional service to out there to the profession and the community. I get people to present for about 5 to 10 minutes on each one and then we discuss. So they'll present the whole case and then we sit down and say, okay, let's discuss the teaching case. Then we move on, let's discuss the research, let's discuss the service and the professional community service, and then we vote. That's right. So again, it's handled differently in each faculty, but from what I understand, talking around the other exec deans, there's a lot of similarities. First up, before we start to talk about each case, I asked if there's any conflict of interest. Now, often there is. So, for instance, I've had heads of school go for promotion. I always declare that as conflict of interest because I'm the direct supervisor. We then decide how to handle that conflict of interest. In those cases, what I usually ask to do is I will contribute to the conversation. You have my letter for that applicant, but I will not vote. But we handle them all differently. But it's always better, and you need to know this, if there are people on the committee, and you can see who's on the committee for your faculties, that person, if they know you will probably declare a conflict of interest and may then be asked not to vote or may decide not to vote. Okay. Weightings. Everyone agonises over the weightings, and occasionally people don't get promoted because they've chosen the wrong weightings. Right? And when that's the case, we tell applicants that. The committee does not see your weightings till after the committee has voted. So sometimes people will try and give hints in their application. That's kind of up to you. Usually we can tell whether it's more strongly weighted towards teaching and research, for instance. But again, the weightings are not revealed until after we've voted. The other thing is, we do use the whole range of 1 to 10 very occasionally people will vote under three. If something's coming in under three, usually a head of school would have suggested it gets pulled and put in another year later. But it's your right to put it in, and every now and then people will insist on putting something in where it's just not there. So typically the range is more between 7 and 10, because it's either going to be strong or it's going to be outstanding. That's the usual, but we do use the full range. Okay? And occasionally we do give 10s across the board. So you just need to know that. Where a case is borderline, so usually if it's a 9 or a 10, it's great. If it's an 8, it's usually a clear case as well. But where we start to get 7.8, 7.9, it's an indicator. We can still promote when it's a 7.8, 7.9, but we'll look at a range of other factors there. We will always revisit those cases, usually immediately, to see if anyone feels that they're an outlier, that they've been too harsh, or, you know, when you look at everyone else's scores, because we don't consult, we put our scores in and then that's all revealed. We also will revisit at the end of the session or the day to make sure we've treated everyone equally. So it wasn't that we were harsher at the beginning of the day than we were at the end. Okay, we will always do that. But again, I think you need to be reassured. It's really rare for there not to be very close scores. People tend to come to a point of consensus really remarkably quickly at all the levels of committees I've been on.
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah.
I probably should know. What do you mean by the weightings? Is that the SILT weightings?
No. You choose what proportion. A standard academic is a 40-40-20 academic.
Okay.
So teaching, research and service. But we have all sorts of other proportions in the university. What we're trying to do now is align your actual weightings with your role statement. That's what it means. But that's your choice, okay? And we do have people, for instance, who might now be scholarly teaching fellows, but who will say, but it's going on in the last 5 years, and in the last 4 years, I was a 40-40-20 academic, so I actually wanted my weightings to reflect that, not my current status. So those are discussions you have with your head of school or your supervisor, if it's not the head of school. Critical. Evidence is critical. Oh, sorry, up the back.
Those weightings, I'm not sure whether we should align with what our academic statement is, you know, like our role.
You should. But again, because those role statements are relatively recent, we do have people whose actual workload in the past did not align with that. And that's where we get a bit of a mismatch. So in that case, it's really good to consult with your head of school and with HR. And we had some of those cases last year. Certainly at the BNC level, we had a couple in my faculty in that boat. If you're not sure, ask someone. Yeah. Evidence. So, yeah, you've just got to present the evidence. I mean, this is pretty straightforward, but we can't go on speculation. We actually have to see it. So head of school has to see it. If you can, put it in the application. So this is especially if you're on a large grant and you're one of a number of people. We actually need you to show the head of school that you are the lead person on it, okay? Because often it comes up, am I leading, am I, you know, just a member of the team? So not so critical going from A to B and B to C. It's certainly far more critical at the level D and E. We have to demonstrate leadership, okay? Remember also to use the kind of measures that work in your discipline. So citations for a number of you are really important. In my disciplines, I'm a musician, but in my disciplines broadly in the faculty, citations are really not relevant except in some of the social and the physical geography, so social sciences. Some of physical geography have enough citations to be of meaning, but most of the humanities and social sciences, they don't. So use the kind of citations that make sense in your discipline area, okay? And use whatever evidence you can provide for that. Where you don't have that, use evidence of peer review. And that goes for teaching and for research. So if you have an article out, someone writes to you and says, this is the best article I've read on this subject, I'm giving it to my PhD students to read, put it in there. That is a really important email, okay? So I've said evidence of peer review. We also have, sort of in my faculty now, we have a quality index where we've ranked publishers. So you need to refer to that, and that's quite explicit now, okay? The other thing that's good evidence,
Sorry, just on the peer review point. If a journal is known as a peer reviewed journal, we don't need to provide further evidence beyond that, do we?
You should say what it is. So if it's what kind of quality is. You could say, look, on the old era, quality measures, it was an A+, A star. You know, you could say that, because again, even though that's not used externally, internally we do use them, and most universities do. That's it's rough. It's not gone suddenly from an A star to a C. You know, so you can say that kind of thing. Yeah. And look, other examples I've given here. If you've been asked to chair a conference session, if you've asked to give a guest paper somewhere, that's all evidence of the quality of your work and the impact you're having. Okay. Now, impact is more recent. We are focusing more and more on the impact of what you do. In some disciplines, that's really hard. We're going through the impact engagement exercise nationally at the moment. Certainly in some of my disciplines, they're very engaged, but the impact is hard to show. So some of you will have a lot of that evidence, some of you will have none. That's okay, you put in what you have. We're not asking you to cover absolutely everything. It's just really drawing on your strengths, making sure we understand what those are. The one thing I just warn about, when people say, oh, I've had this article, you know, it's published with this online press, it's been downloaded 30,000 times. You can put that in, it's not the same as it being cited a large number of times. So just be aware, they don't equate. Okay. Referees. Now you have referees, you choose the referees. Okay. So the referees can be internal or external for level B. For level C, the referee must be external. I just warn you about choosing external referees. Affiliates and title holders are internal. So don't go and choose someone who has a title holder position at the university. If in doubt, you can ask HR to check for you. Because sometimes someone might be, you think, well, they're not associated with the university, but they are in another faculty. So just double check that, okay? This is one I often get a lot of questions about, but generally, better if the referee is not someone who's too close to you. So if you're a recent PhD graduate, try not to use your supervisor, okay? If you have to, you do, but that may be seen as a conflict of interest, all right? So again, if someone has recently co-authored or collaborated with you within the last 5 years, ideally don't use them as an assessor, okay? Yes, they know your work, but they're not going to say this article's terrible that we co-wrote, okay? So it will be viewed with a bit of suspicion. So distant is better. Trust yourself. If you're a strong applicant, you can approach someone who's big in the field who doesn't know your work necessarily, but will go out and know it, or say, actually, I've read this person's stuff, or I've heard them talk at a conference. So you have to trust the quality of what you do, I think. And again, your referees should ideally be able to comment on all aspects of your application. Sometimes we get a referee who says, well, I'm only going to comment on the research case. They're not supposed to. They're actually asked in your letter, and there's a template you can see to comment on all aspects. But look, we deal with that, and that's why we ask the kind of multiple assessors if we possibly can. Okay? Referees. Yeah.
So what sort of external referees we need to find? Because you're saying that the person shouldn't be a co-author or a collaborator, but
a little bit distant.
Should be able to comment on all aspects of the application.
Well,
so
no, but they'll get the application.
Someone who we don't know, so it's going to be very difficult, you know, to put your comments on the whole application.
No, it won't be. I mean, we do this all the time. I'm asked to do promotion applications all the time for other universities in Australia and overseas. So you have to trust that within your discipline, you know, your typical associate professor or professor has done this many times before. If they don't feel comfortable doing it, they'll say no. So if they feel comfortable, so if you write to them and say, look, there's a template, you'll see the wording for it. So you can approach them, and it's a bit scary, I understand that. Mostly people will agree to do it. And then when they get the package, and look, I get these approaches all the time. So I get written to by a university or by the applicant, depending on the policy at that university. I will usually say yes. If it looks from the title of you know, what they're doing, their role, the department they're in, that I'm able to assess it, I'll say yes. And then I'll get the file, you know, a few weeks or a month later. Sometimes we have assessors then say, referees and assessors then say, I can't do it. Suddenly there's family illness or something's cropped up, and we madly contact you and ask for somebody else. That does happen. HR has to deal with that. But usually people, once they've agreed to do it, will do it. We very, very rarely have people actually just... We did have one last year, not at this level, but a higher level, who was just non-responsive, and we had to go very last minute to somebody else who agreed last minute, as in 2 days before the committee met. And actually was ended up being a very good assessor for a DE case. So, you do have to try and just trust yourself. This might, so I think, is what I do strong enough that someone looking at it, is the case I've made in my application strong enough that someone from outside the university is going to understand it? Then it should be okay.
Does the external referee has to come from a dual university?
Not at this level, yes, for D and E.
Right.
Yeah, one has to be GO8 and one has to be international for D and E. That's not a requirement we make for B and C promotion. Yeah. Good if you can, but it's not a requirement.
That's a requirement.
Yeah.
In terms of for those of us who have very good 4 to 5 business schools, I'm a law school academic, is it problematic to ask for a reference from a professor in a business school rather than a law school?
No.
Or
not at all. That's absolutely okay. Yeah.
Oh, I just wanted to clarify in the context of that earlier question about how someone could write a referee about a national notice because they have the whole, have you completed?
They have your whole application.
You need that information for it to make sense.
Yeah. If you look at the template of the letter, that does makes it clear what they'll be able to see. And then I think, so they get everything. So they'll get yourself, they'll get everything you put in the application they see. Yeah.
And just for internal, for those going to
Yep.
What sort of guidelines are there around finding
the same thing? Ideally, not someone who has supervised you or worked really closely with you, a little bit of distance. So ideally someone in the same school or same discipline. But again, depending on the work that you do, you need to get someone who you think will look at your case fairly and be able to understand it. Yeah. Okay. Right. So again, I've mentioned this before. So we've had a couple of years now with the new weightings. So it is something people stress about a bit and they change them last minute, all the rest of that. But again, have those discussions early on with your head of school. Maybe just say, honestly, how do you see me? You know, am I a 40-40-20? A lot of people want to think of themselves as 40-40-20, but they're not. And if your research is a little bit weaker, I'd say consider pushing up your teaching. If you've got good CELTs and good evidence of peer review, if you don't have the CELTs that your teaching's fine, then, just change those weightings a little bit. Again, it comes back to the question at the back there about aligning it with the role statements. As we go forward, it is going to be more and more aligned with your role statements, but we're still in a bit of a transition space there. Okay. Practical tips, start early. Again, it always takes longer than you think to get the evidence together. And sometimes people just say, actually, it's too much work, I've got to do it next year. But at least you know how much time it's going to take you next time around. Okay? Don't get your applications late to the head of school. That tends to make head of schools a little bit annoyed. It's not the tone you want in the letter from the head of school. So get it to them with plenty of time. If there's anything holding you up, let them know. Okay? Please follow the templates. That's so often we have people put in an application and the font's too small and the margins are not there. And the templates are there for a reason. So just use them, stick to the limits. And again, promotion is a choice. It's not something you have to do. There might be pressure on you to go, but it has to be your choice about when you're ready. Some people leave it way too late. Some people go too early. If you go too early and everyone's telling you it's too early, don't be surprised if you don't get up. Sometimes people do get up, but don't be surprised if you don't get up. Okay. We try and assign mentors for people. It's really good to have someone who looks at your application and ideally someone even a little bit outside your discipline, because that's the kind of person who's going to be reading this, right? And I've done that one. I had one head of school at another university give me 15 drafts of his application before he put it in. And he got it. But the first draft, I said, you're too much in the middle of all of this. I don't actually understand the case that you're trying to make. So he had to kind of pull himself out and look at sometimes people write it in the third person and then turn it back into the first person just to get that little bit of distance there. The other thing I wanted to talk about was special consideration. There are a couple of ways in which you can use special consideration. So it's open to men and women. It's not just women. It's often if people have had maternity leave or carer's leave for some reason, or dealing with a chronic illness of themselves or a family member, or any kind of career break. So have a look at the policy. It's at the discretion of the DVCA, goes to Pascal for consideration. She certainly does say both yes and no to cases. There are some things that are clearly outside special consideration. So just saying, oh, my workload's too high, that's not special consideration. So it really needs to be that issue of, I've had 2 children in the last 6 years or something like that, and this has had an impact on my ability to run my lab or go to conferences or that kind of thing. Or I've had a chronic illness that I've been managing and it meant I had to change from being out in the field to being lab-based. These things happen. So we need to know that. And then you can use the special consideration in 2 ways, right? So one is to say, and it often comes up with maternity leave, instead of everything being considered over the last 5 years, I'd like the extra time I took maternity leave considered, taken into effect, and so I want to have 6 years considered, or 6.5. So there's a way of working it out, okay? Or you can do the special consideration that says, because I had a chronic illness and was not able to do X and Y, I would just like the committee to consider these 2 areas. So it, one of them has to be teaching or research, the other needs to be administration or the professional service. So then we actually look at just 2 areas. So anyway, don't think that it's not an important consideration, and it may well apply to you. We get special consideration cases every year at all levels. Okay. That's probably all I've said. The rest of it is really just following the instructions. Please follow the instructions. This is my last page. Okay. So just a couple of things here. So heads of school letters. So you see them. You see the head of school letter. If it's a head of school letter saying this person's not ready, you might want to pull your application, all right? Because we will all see that letter, including the external referees. And that usually, unless we think it's a hostile letter, we do get some hostile letters occasionally, but really that's rare. Most of your head of school has your best interests in mind. And if that person is saying not quite ready, almost there, I'd sort of suggest that's a hint to pull it. Okay. We also have to say in the letter, the head has to say whether your behaviour is consistent with our code of conduct. And with I'd say it's rare that anyone's not ticking that box if you're going for promotion. But also you need to meet the minimum expectations of the relevant Adelaide role statement. That's, again, relatively new. And also whether the head of school expects you to meet the minimum expectations of the level to which you seek promotion. So it's worth checking. If you're going level A's, you don't really have that role statement, but look at what's in the level B's role statement, and a level B is going to see, look at what the expectations are of the level C role statement, okay? We like the heads letters to be frank. We do encourage the heads of schools not to just say this person's fabulous. That's really unhelpful. We actually want them to pick out what your strengths are and where you have developing areas, so don't take that badly. That's not the same as being, a statement saying not quite ready, all right? We also like the head of school letters to be quite detailed. So again, don't take a detailed letter negatively. That's someone who's spending the time to make a case for you, okay? Short letters that are glowing don't tend to have, sometimes they can actually work against you. So, just be aware of that. And again, as I've said, the referees, just coming back to those referees that are, especially if you've picked someone, let's say a GOA, okay? So you've chosen someone who says, well, I don't know Fred, but, the research in this area appears to be outstanding and the CELTs are fantastic and this person appears to be working really well as a university citizen. That's going to mean a lot, okay? So, again, if it's your supervisor writing, we're going to be saying, the supervisor's not going to say anything bad about your research. So it's just you've got to be aware sometimes it can be not as helpful as you'd think. I think that's it for me. So if there's any other questions, I'm happy to take them. Yeah, what's the back?
One question. Does the reputation of the referee, the guy who will give us the letters, important?
Is the profession?
Yeah, it's like the reputation of the referee, is it important? Does it help?
Especially at D&E, yes, it is really important. You want to pick someone who's certainly a well-regarded academic, yeah.
In that case, do we need to describe to explain that in the application?
No, we don't. Some policies at some universities actually need to include a little paragraph description. I've had to do that before, to show that this person is an active publishing, researching scholar, for instance. Our policy, we don't. We're relying on you to pick good people in the field. So I'd say the most important factor is to pick someone who's a reputation for being fair and generous. Because we have colleagues out there, and you all know that, who are a little bit nasty. So don't go to someone like that, okay, who's got a point to prove. I also feel it's often good to go to people who are quite senior, not in years, but senior in terms of their standing in the university hierarchy. So an associate professor, rather than someone who might have just been promoted a couple of years ago. And sometimes it comes out that those people have something to prove, and there's a little bit of, the applicant's not as good as I was at the same stage. You don't want that. So often people who've kind of more comfortable with where they are in their careers are able to give a fairer assessment of where you are in yours. So that would be my only warning about where you pick people. But yeah, look, we're able to assess that. You know, sometimes, and again, it's not likely to be such an issue where you get the assessor's report back and you will see that. It's more of an issue at level D&E where those reports are confidential. Yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit about the voting in the committee at the end?
Sure. Really, oh, okay. All right. Well, if you look at the promotions, I know there's a lot of material, but we use a range of scores. So it's 1 to 10.
Yep.
9 and 10 are outstanding. Okay. Anything under a 7 is iffy. So basically, you'll see the descriptors there. So 7 to 10 is areas of strength. 5 to 6 is developing. Under that, really needs a lot of work. Okay. So what we do is we discuss the cases. So we'll discuss, we'll take one applicant. So we just do them one at a time. So you're not being measured against anyone else at the beginning. We do at the end of the day, just to make sure we've been fair. But we'll look at an individual's case. As I said, usually in my faculty, someone will present that case, then they'll go through the teaching case, the research case, the service to the university, the professional service, okay, if it's a standard case. All right, different if it's research focused, different if it's a special consideration case. We will then have a discussion, usually in turn, discussion focus on the teaching case, any questions people had, other comments, any points that need clarification, then move on to research, then move on to service, then move on to professional activity. Okay, then we will vote. And you have someone there from HR, and we'll sit down and say, might come to me and I might say, 7, 8, 9, 7, okay, in order of those four categories we've just discussed. HR compiles it all in a little chart. Have you got that? Can you just show an example? Yeah, okay, so you'll see that later on, become clearer, okay? And that automatically does the weightings. Yes, it's all out there in the open to the committee. So everyone on the committee knows how everyone else votes. That's how we can see if anyone's an outlier. So someone might have 7 and 8s across the board, but someone might have put a 3 in there. Then we have to decide whether that person decides themselves that that is out of whack with everybody else, or whether I as chair, for instance, might say, I think I'm going to declare that's an outlier, and we'll look at the voting again without that score in there. Yeah, so we have discretion. It's a guideline.
That's what was called voting.
Yeah. No, it's not a yes no case. It's a voting of we actually put the scores out there, and then at the end we have a score as a guideline, right? Now, if it's an 8 or above under our policy, that's clearly promotable. And so the discussion at that point will be, this is an 8 and above, this is a decision to promote. Does everyone agree? Okay? And that's just a nod of heads around the room. Again, I've been at other universities where people have yes, no cards or little flags to hold up. It's not like that, okay? We don't do that. But we have to agree that this person is promotable. It's very rare if you get a high score for someone to say, this person is not promotable. That usually there'll be something else at the bottom of that. But that's not what we're looking at. We're looking at the case made in the application. Okay. Two more I can see here.
Jenny, I've got a question about people on soft money.
Yeah.
And how that's handled. Because there's a clause in the EA that application promotion might be considered if anybody hasn't confirmed that extra fund will be available to support that person's promotion. Is in place how's...
Yeah, look, that is a tricky one. That is a very tricky one. It does come up occasionally because I think, we want people to be promoted on merit. Sometimes we have promoted, but then there's no more job at the end of it all. So that's a reality. That's more likely the case to be the case. Again, that's one I think you'd have to discuss. If you're in that situation, you need to discuss it with your head of school, who might then go and have a discussion with the funding body. But usually we have to warn people. If it's an ARC grant, for instance, that's not an issue. We do have people promoted on ARC grants, and we just have to absorb those costs.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So it might be, I mean, my guess is, again, if the funding body is saying, I'm only going to fund at level B, and you get promoted to level C, say, it might be a discussion with the head of school to make sure the head is aware of that and willing to absorb the cost. Usually it's, again, it's merit-based and people go for promotion, get it. So we have people on fixed-term contracts who go all the time. Yeah. Have that discussion, yeah.
I should perhaps know this, just in terms of talking to the school and approaching them, would you be able to give a general class as to when we should do that? So there's lots of applications to translate. And how would
you know? Now. Earlier the better. It's even better to flag it at the end of the previous year. So like around the PDR you'd be having around about November, December. That's the time. So I want to think about going for promotion next year. No, you flag it first and then you decide, have that discussion about when you're going to provide it to the head of school.
Okay.
Yeah. Earlier is always better. No one likes last minute surprises. So, and it does happen. Yeah. Okay. I'll take one more, but I'm aware that we need to move on. Yeah.
My apologies if you did say something before I came in. I was like, can you explain how a 0.5 fits in?
We have lots of people who are 0.5s. Again, we look at your activities kind of pro rata. So
you need to make it explicit in the application.
You do, okay. And I think sometimes that's a special consideration case, okay. So that's one where you need to discuss that with HR and how you might best pitch that. Yeah, because again, we have people on all kinds of different fractions, so down to a 0.4 trying to go for promotion. So we need to know that. That needs to be very clear in your application that you're not full-time. Yeah. Comes up a lot with clinical practitioners and also areas like Eldercon where people have other jobs outside the university. So, yep, we do take that into account.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name's Phil Levy. I'm the Pro Vice Chancellor of Student Learning, if you haven't met me, although there are some familiar faces, which I'm very pleased to see here to me. And I'm going to talk about teaching matters and teaching matters in the submission that you make. And just offer some tips about the teaching portfolio, really. So I'll try and speak fairly rapidly through the slides and give some time for questions. So the key components of your application in terms of the teaching portfolio and what you want, how you want to present yourself as an excellent teacher. First of all, you need to think about the information that you want to provide. That's sort of the information. I'll talk a little bit about what that might look like. Then you want to really highlight the evidence of the effectiveness of what you do. So that's evidence. And then you will be providing some commentary and analysis on the evidence. Really talking about how you use evidence of that you get, perhaps feedback that you get from students, from other sources about your teaching to further develop your teaching. Okay, so it's more than just a list of activities and contributions, things you do. That's the information bit. That's important, but it's not enough. And ultimately, what you're seeking to provide is evidence of a scholarly approach to teaching. That you are somebody who approaches teaching with a mind view whereby you're looking at what you're doing, you're thinking about it in relation to the feedback that you gain, you're making adjustments, you're observing impact on students' learning experiences and outcomes, and you're continuously enhancing your teaching. So I think there's a spectrum of activity that relates to scholarly teaching or that comprises scholarly teaching. And You may not feel that your activities cover all of this. That's absolutely fine. That's fine because different individuals have, you know, are doing different amounts of teaching, and you wouldn't be expected necessarily in relation to your experience to be covering all these elements of the spectrum. But I think the foundational one, of course, is maintaining a deep knowledge of your discipline and how knowledge is created in your discipline. So through research and other knowledge creation activities. Keeping abreast of contemporary developments, knowing your stuff, you know. That's really the foundation of scholarly teaching, of course. And then thinking about how you apply sound pedagogy, sound understanding of learning and teaching in the discipline to how you go about teaching. There's no one recipe about how to go about teaching in your discipline, but what are the principles that you apply and why? And how does that look? And with what impact does that make on the student experience? Integrating discipline knowledge effectively in curriculum development and learning resource creation. So you may have done particular work around that, creating content, whether that be textbooks, whether it be digital resources. So thinking about how you integrate your personal knowledge base into resource creation for students. So that's really about pedagogy and learning resources. Then there's the enhancing pedagogical practice through a range of activities, through critical reflection and inquiry. You may be carrying out evaluation of innovations, you may be carrying out research into what you do, or you may be a member of a community of practice where you have opportunities to discuss your teaching and you get feedback from colleagues. You, of course, get student feedback through ESELS, but you may also be running other mechanisms for seeking student feedback. You may be gaining peer feedback, perhaps formally through peer review, perhaps in less formal ways, and that's fine too. Make sure you bring those out. And informed experimentation, so having a go at doing something new and evaluating it, testing it out. Scholarly teaching also may involve sharing and disseminating what you do. So telling others about it and putting what you do up to scrutiny by peers. And that, again, could take less formal and more formal forms. Either is fine. Don't forget the informal ways in which you share and disseminate practice. It's easy to think about, you know, workshops you might have been invited to run internally or externally, those kinds of things that we do at that kind of level. But think also about how you share and disseminate, perhaps through program teams or course teams, and seek to get feedback from colleagues in that way. And of course, your leadership contributions. Again, could be of a number of different kinds and levels. Could be about course coordination, program direction, could be about the development of a new, refresh of a new program, the development of a new program. It might be that you play a leadership role at the faculty or in the institutional or sector level. So make sure you think about those. That's all comes under the general heading of scholarly teaching. So to come back to, and I'll perhaps highlight a few of those in the next few slides, just some further tips about those. In terms of information, what information should you include? Well, of course, you need to include just the details of what you actually do at undergraduate, postgraduate coursework level, HDR supervision. So, and also of the teaching activities and approaches that you use. How do you do it? Do you do SGDE, for example? Are you mainly running lectures, tutorials, lab classes, etc., etc.? Really give the panel a clear picture of what it is you're actually doing and with whom on what courses. Don't forget the online aspects of what you do. Very important. We do a lot of blended learning in the institution, and you may be doing some fantastic stuff online to complement your face-to-face. Actually, and if you are talking about online, do also, it's worth explaining how you use online to complement face-to-face, how they work together, how you design for learning in that sense. And then an overview of your goals and achievements. A summary of your main strengths. You may have won awards and prizes. So that's information about your achievements. Okay. And really, I've talked mostly through this. Information about new courses and programs, approaches that have led to demonstrable improvements, examples of innovation, new approaches to teaching, but also assessment, really important. Yes, please.
Excuse me. Would you prefer to see the application in an informative way or in the context of the teaching philosophy, for example, to put all these aspects in the teaching philosophy format? Or we just address, for example, this criteria?
So Jenny may be able to comment more on from the perspective of the panel itself. My instinct would be perhaps to provide kind of some factual information, perhaps up front, just to say this is what I do, this is my philosophy, you know, this is how I, you know, and this is how I go about it. So this is my philosophy, and this is how I do it. So, but I don't think there's any one size fits all approach. Would that be the case, Jenny?
No, that's right. We see all kinds of different ways people present it, and it's what works for you. So sometimes people start with philosophy up front and then present the rest of the facts. Sometimes when people get what I tend to like is a little summary of the facts up front, then the philosophy.
That would be. That would be probably my preference if I was looking at this too, because it's nice to have that context right up front. Then you get into the philosophy and the how, and you think, okay, yes, it's in relation to this activity. But so innovation. Okay, evidence. So as I said earlier on, evidence, it's all about how effective what you do is, really. In relation to students' learning outcomes and your objectives, of course. So this could be all sorts of things, but it could be evidence of inclusive teaching strategies, for example, or as evidence of where you're really aiming to engage students actively in activity-based learning or in discovery-oriented learning through SGDE. And to be able to show not only what you do, but the impact of that on student, as I say, student experience, but especially outcomes. You may also be able to provide evidence of leadership and mentoring and the impact that has had. Again, it's not just what you've done. You know, I've been a mentor for a number of staff, but how has that affected them? And what have they done as a consequence of conversations with you to change their practice and improve their practice? You know, that kind of thinking. And evidence of leadership in teaching within and beyond your immediate environment. And again, it's not the information, it's about what the impact of that leadership has been on other people, faculties, institutions, whatever. So you'll be drawing on relevant student evaluation data. Not only perhaps the data that you get from students, but the feedback you provide to students about the changes that you intend to make. You will have evidence of your teaching from peer review. Perhaps not everybody. There are two streams in the peer review scheme that we currently run. One is less formal and is based on peer support. It's more formatively oriented. That's PARD P. TRP is the more formal scheme where you gain feedback from two peers within our peer review college. If you can provide TRP-based evidence, that's really strong evidence to support your case. Evidence of reflective practice. You may have made changes as a result of evaluations, literature reviews, whatever, you know, you're reading, you're going to conferences, whatever. Invitations to teach, present or publish, and publication in relevant journals. Okay. Grants and awards for teaching and learning related activity, qualifications for further study in appropriate higher education studies programs. Again, these things, if you've been on a course and you've, you know, really thought about your teaching, changed your teaching as a result, then the next question is, with what impact? You know. You may be an examiner for postgrad theses on higher education, and you may be leading workshops and teaching seminars and so on. You will have CELT data, of course. Do, of course, consider the nature of the CELT data that you have. Think about the response rate and what it can say meaningfully about your teaching, the spread of results, in relation to the length of the course and the extent of your contribution. So, you know, you're more likely to want to focus on CELT's data where you're perhaps the course coordinator or you've had a very significant chunk of teaching on that course than CELT data where perhaps you've just done an hour. You know, you're going to have a stronger case to make in the first example. You will want to look at and present the broad agreement percentage scores against those items that are used for broad agreement and compare that with the aggregates. So compare your teacher ESELs with those of other teachers in your school, faculty and wider university. If you're up there, then you've got a really great case to make. If you've got a good response rate or a reasonable response rate. There's a lot of anxiety and concern about CELT's response rates at the moment, and we are actually reviewing the way we do CELT's to see if we can't, you know, find ways to increase response rate. So, and I think the panel is aware of the challenges of getting, you know, really good response rates around CELT's. Some courses get that, others really don't. And there is awareness, and that will be taken into account, I think, in the panel deliberations. But, you know, where you've got a good response rate or a reasonable response rate and you've got great comparison data, then put it forward, really highlight it. So, and this is about communicating. Be explicit. One of my big tips is, you know, don't take it for granted that, the information you provide or the evidence that you present is sort of self-evident in terms of what it's saying. It's difficult to, it's difficult sometimes to kind of perhaps boast, you know, but this is the time when you really need to point to what the evidence means. Yes?
Just a question on the previous slide about the response rate.
I'm sorry?
A question on the response rate. So in this case, what's the indication for that? Because it's out of our control, the response rate, just like what's the indication of that? If it's too low or too high?
Well, it's just, if the... Whether or not it's out of our control is perhaps a discussion we should have on another occasion, because it's a really interesting issue, actually. But yes, at the moment, I think response rates certainly are very variable across the institution. And if you have low response rates, then I think all you can really say is, well, you know, you need to acknowledge that, and you need to say how you do use that data. What a lot of colleagues say is that even when the quantitative response rate is quite low, the qualitative responses from that small number of students can be incredibly useful for enhancement and development. Acknowledging that it's from, nevertheless, coming from a small segment of the student body. So there are ways that you can use that data meaningfully, I think. If you are actually doing something over and above CELTS to get feedback from your students about their experience, then do highlight that as well, because I know a lot of colleagues do, and so you may be gathering more data than comes through CELTS and responding to that.
Just on this topic, what's the expected response rate for ESELTS?
There is no expected response rate for ESELTS. There's no expectation. We haven't set that as yet. These things we're having some really interesting and important discussions about this within the review. But broadly speaking, 30% or 35% is pretty good. And that's not just in this institution, but across the sector. So, yeah. And we have to be pragmatic. Comment on the evidence. And provide some reflection about, you know, how the feedback you receive relates to how you think about teaching, how you've responded. And it may be occasionally that you haven't responded to what students have requested because you have taken a judgment about what, you know, the way that you should do your teaching in this class. And so that's fine. You need to provide your own analysis and provide a justification for how you respond to feedback, both to student feedback and also to perhaps peer review feedback and other peer feedback. And think about what other factors might have contributed to good or poor outcomes. So it's all about demonstrating reflection. That's all I had prepared to say. Your teaching portfolio, as you know, its purpose is this. It is a really important part of your submission. Teaching does matter. The teaching portfolio really matters. There are lots of ways that you can demonstrate good practice and excellence in teaching, drawing on data at your disposal. So do really take that part very seriously. Thank you. Are there any further questions? Yes.
Is it compulsory to have the formal peer review for when we apply for level C?
I'm sorry, the compulsory to have the...
The formal peer review for teaching.
It's not compulsory, no. It's available for those colleagues who would like to do that. There is currently a round taking place. It is too late to be involved in the current round. Look out for opportunities in the future. We have got quite a lot of colleagues actually who are participating in that round, which is great. It's not compulsory, but it will strengthen, I think, if you know.
In fact, we were asked to withdraw because you were inundated with applicants.
So we
and to make our sort of development next semester.
Okay, so if there are colleagues who are wishing to go for promotion, it isn't required. That's true. It isn't required. It's a useful thing to have.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look, just a quick comment on that. There are some areas in which it's essential because some areas do not have results. They do not have the numbers because the numbers are so small. And again, especially the two areas that always come up, clinical areas and elder con, where we've got one-to-one and results are identified because we don't use them. So in that case, peer review is essential.
That's correct.
For most of you, you will have enough data from your CELTs to cover the requirement there. You've got to provide a set number. So it's only an issue if you've got gaps.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I think that the part that you've given your informal process with the permission of our peer, can we use that? Data?
Absolutely. I would really encourage that. Yes, absolutely. So if you're in PARDP, which is the informal peer support process, and you've received feedback through that process, and you can also demonstrate what you've done in response to that feedback, then I think that's great.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think it is. I'm Julie Owens. I'm PVC Research Strategy and Acting DVCR. And I'm delighted to be able to come along today and just talk to you briefly about your promotion application and really how to best present your research. But I also want to touch on how you actually build your research success so that you have a great track record and body of work and achievement to present. So I'm going to briefly touch on how you build that research success and importantly the impact it has, be it on knowledge or in its translation into a whole range of different benefits for our communities and stakeholders. I'm going to talk about, first of all, the questions you address, building a team so that you can actually undertake something substantial, critically resourcing, otherwise it's just not going to progress very quickly or at all in some disciplines, and finally impact, ensuring that you have impact, the sort of impact that's consistent with our mission as a university, but also impact you can describe. So, first of all, in terms of what questions should you be asking in order to be able to really progress academically and really be one of the leaders in terms of your research? Mike Brooks likes to say, eschew the incremental. I still haven't got around to changing it. I haven't come up with anything else at this point. So I think what it is, it's about really creativity, novelty, in terms of the questions that you address. Not just adding to perhaps the existing body of work in an incremental way. Now, much of your research, or some of your research at least, might have to consist of that, but you should always be looking for the big question. These will be difficult, but even in failing to completely address them or answer them, you'll have success. One way to do that and keep in mind is explore interdisciplinary boundaries or disciplinary boundaries, and that's because that forcing yourself or working to look at how other disciplines approach perhaps this question or set of questions, or just how they approach their questions generally, can really open up your mind to really be much more creative, I guess, in addressing particular questions, particularly complex ones or ones that will produce a big breakthrough. Also important to keep in mind that what the university mission is about is discovering new knowledge, but it's also about translating that into benefit for our communities here and around the world. And you know, we now describe it as innovation, but it's translation in all sorts of ways. And either or a mixture of both is what the university will value, and it does value, and it will value in your promotion application when it's looking at your track record. You don't have to have all discovery research outcomes or some. It could in fact be a portfolio that's based around innovation. The next thing that's crucial is having a team, and this can be a virtual team, but it also can be an in-place real team co-located with you. The key thing is to work with the top people. Seek out the best talent, but also the leaders in the field, and attempt to cultivate a real collaboration with them and learn from them. We say collaborate internationally. That really means look to find the best wherever they are. It could be locally, it could be nationally, but it well may be internationally. And really, you're then taking yourself outside your comfort zone, business as usual, and are much more likely, I think, to have an innovative, creative approach to your work. And it's critical then to build a team, but keep in mind, there's the team that you build in place, but there's also that team of collaborators that could be around the world and that give you additional opportunities, access to additional resources, both intellectual and otherwise. But it is important to build your own team, and really you start out working with undergraduates. It could be in research projects, summer scholarships, honours. You certainly need to recruit and develop PhD students, and hopefully as you go along, particularly as you start to attract resources to a greater extent, then you can be looking at talented early and mid-career postdocs. Importantly, you must make the most of the resources you do manage to attract. You must make the most of the trainees that you're responsible for. And really being able to project manage effectively, manage yourself, you know, good personal effectiveness. And importantly, compliance. We live in an increasingly regulatory sort of environment, I guess, but it's absolutely crucial that you don't get yourself and your group into unnecessary difficulties, I guess, because you've missed some compliance issues and so on. And that's about research ethics, integrity, but a whole range of other elements as well. A funding body may require you to expend all your monies before the end of a certain year, a certain date. Don't miss that. So resourcing, really challenging, was always challenging, but more challenging than ever. I think the key thing always has been, particularly now, is to seek funding from many different sources, local, national, but international. I think it's important that you look at the whole range of types of schemes that are available. It can be projects, fairly standard, but it could be programs, be part of a big program team, part of a centre application. Look for fellowships. Even if you have a continuing position, you're eligible for fellowships of various types. Not all of them, but many of them. Don't ignore philanthropic funding. Also, we're in the process of developing a crowdfunding policy. Now, it has to be said, this is envisaged as only ever being a modest source of income, but for some disciplines, that could be quite substantial. As much as anything, it's probably about building our external engagement, but not to be ignored. Most importantly, engage with industry and government. And we're certainly working hard. We're getting ready to, through Adelaide Innovation, one of the major themes in the research strategic plan, to launch the incubator up on the corner of Portland and North Terrace. There's going to be a whole range of support services there that are going to be available to you. It's really going to make it a lot easier for you to engage with industry, to know what the opportunities are that are out there. And that extends to Adelaide Global, because we're certainly building a high degree of engagement and productive partnerships with various regions around the world, particularly China, for example. Finally, impact. This is all about actually making a material contribution to knowledge, to translation, to generate benefit. It's important to keep that in mind from the start. If you ask the big questions or tough questions and really are creative with that, you will generate findings that must have impact. But it's important to ensure that impact is realised. Now, when it comes to publications, go for the best journals. Really try and make the publication accessible as widely as possible, in terms of someone from outside your discipline could read it and get, you know, a sense of what it's about. Go perhaps for general journals rather than specialist ones as a first port of call. The same with innovation, and that is to understand what you have. Is there the potential for innovation? To again work with, I think, the strategic pipeline for innovation that we're building up more, and make sure you make the most of it. It's important to communicate your achievements, and I'll talk about that a little bit more later. When you're about to publish something, or there's, you know, have patent something, license something, talk to the media unit. You've got Altmetrics now in your Aurora web page list. Really important to maximise that. And make sure you are known and seen. Part of building up that collaborative network is going to conferences, but going up and talking to people about your work, about their work, and building that network. So when it comes to the inputs and outputs that are going to matter in terms of ultimately a promotion application or applying for funding, fellowships, everything really that matters in terms of resourcing, the obvious inputs are funding through a range of schemes. It can be competitive grants, or it can be industry funding, consultancies and contracts. It's the students recruited, and importantly, when we come to outputs, publications, but there's a number of outputs that some people may generate, such as patents, licenses, reports, which are really surrogate impact measures for translation, for example. So these are all important. It's important to understand how you can use them as evidence. The conferences you've attended, but particularly invited plenaries and keynotes, and it's important to contribute to organising conferences to build up collaboration links that increase your chances. And frankly, I just ask people, ask organising committees, people on organising committees that you know, to invite you. Prizes and awards. We're making a big effort to contact people across the university in relation to a whole range of local and national and even international prizes and awards that are available, and to provide some support for people to be nominated or to nominate themselves. And we're hoping we'll have the same success as we had last year when we started with the South Australia Science Awards and so on. Outcomes for your students in terms of completions, grades, really important. Great evidence that you are really exerting research leadership and delivering what the university wants. So just coming to applying for promotion, I just want to make a few key points, and I'm sure it's similar to what Philippa and others have made. The obvious things you have to provide is a CV, a commentary, and evidence of your achievements. For research, publications, lists, but importantly, evidence of publication quality. And again, we just have surrogate indices of these, but it's important to have them and to gather them and keep them in mind. And there can be other types of evidence, depending on the discipline you're in and what sort of work you've been doing. I want to make one point, but I think people are getting a better feeling for this, and that is the academic role statement and the benchmarks there are minimum standards for going into formal performance management. They are not your target when you're going for promotion at the next level. They are not as a target. So when you're really planning your research career and you're seeking to drive towards success, you've got to get well above that, okay? That's what your target should be. And I should add that we're desperately working hard to come up with aspirational benchmarks, so that will give people a better guide. Now, they're not going to be the standard or the cutoff for promotion or not, but I think it's going to give people a better sense of what is reasonable. And they will be in a discipline-specific, sensitive fashion, and we'll be using the GO8, for example, as a source of that kind of benchmarking. So four key things about research outputs. You need to look for what evidence you can provide about quality, and metrics is an obvious thing. Peer review, more difficult, but I know the Faculty of Arts and Rachel Ankeny are working on ways to address that, and we're looking for them to share that with professions. Quantity, both the quality and the quantity evidence and metrics have to be discipline specific, because they can vary substantially. Need to provide context too, what is, you know, outstanding research achievement in this particular discipline, but you need to look for the leaders in the field to, you know, who are, and perhaps people at a comparable stage of career in order to really put that correct context. And finally, evidence of creativity. And this is important in terms of the narrative you construct. You've got to try and put in there a bit about your thinking, why what you've done is creative and innovative in a generation of new knowledge and so on way. It's important to have got out there and really create a bit of a profile through conferences and other things so that your referees can point, can recognise or know about the fact that you are creative, you're a leader in thinking and new thinking in this field. They may have to rely on what's in the narrative, so just keep that in mind. You're not just going to present a list and numbers. You've actually got to explain a bit about the path, the journey you went on. I hate saying that, but anyway. So in terms of quality, there are a range of types of evidence. If people are collaborating with you, that can be evidence. Interdisciplinary research that's successful means that you're doing some challenging things. Obvious things, prizes and awards, recognition in terms of Learned Academy membership, journal editing, but importantly, hard metrics. Again, recognising that that can be a challenge around peer review based disciplines, but again, that's something we hope we'll address shortly. And alt metrics as well. So the ways in which you can pull out that kind of evidence, you've got your own individual academic profile data, Google Scholar, which helpfully includes outputs relation to humanities and social sciences. How meaningful the citation rates and so on are is another question. There are era-based or related benchmarked relative citation rates. Importantly, your individual academic profile has more up-to-date normalised citation indices. So it's really how well cited you are compared to everyone else in your field publishing similar journals. There's a lot of relevant evidence in Aurora. Important to make sure that you've got that up to date and that you don't have missing publications and so on. And getting an ORCID number is very helpful at ensuring that you can maintain that and maintain it easily. And also a PhD supervision record. So in terms of quantity, I've talked about discipline standards and so on. And we, as I said, through the aspirational benchmarks we want to provide in terms of individual academic profiles, we hope that'll become more readily available. But talk to your Associate Dean Research to get access to that discipline standard if you haven't already got it. So just a bit more on publication quality then. These are the range of, if you like, indices you can use for that. The RCI, the NCI, which we do ourselves with a new license we've got for Thomson Reuters. Our quality factor from peer review, which arts and hopefully professions are trying to generate where they're available. In terms of quality of the output, you can refer to your grant funding achievements. That's a reflection of it as well, but in itself an important type of evidence, as is the number of students. So creativity and relative to the discipline, this is where the narrative is really important, particularly if you can point to reviews, for example, or editorials or commentaries, perhaps, which were highly cited or well received. If someone wrote a commentary on one of your publications, all of that is really helpful independent evidence that you've made a contribution of distinction. Focus on your strongest outputs in terms of their importance and impact, and relative citation rate isn't everything. You can actually publish something which is really changes a particular field quite a lot. you can talk about capacity building of teams that the best in the world, or nationally at least, work with, and so on. All of that is to help your referee out if they don't know you directly or are not so familiar with your field and the body of work, for example. I've really just put this up to remind you to go look at the general standard for level B and also subsequently for level C, so that you know what you're aiming for in qualitative terms. A lot of these are things that you have to do, tick box in a sense, but where is it that it's saying what the standard in terms of your research is that's required? And level B, it's not too onerous. You're expected to carry out activities to maintain or develop your research relevant to the profession or discipline, but supposed to show evidence of experience, creative achievement, and or technical achievement. But really, to guarantee promotion, I'd be, you know, really to highlight in where you've gone beyond that. And that's it. So no C's. This is just level B?
Level B and C.
Oh, okay. Oh, fine. Okay. No, that's fine. So really with level C, it's where you start to see distinction and leadership coming in more. So it's really important to make sure your narrative focuses on that. And importantly, in developing your research career trajectory and so on, to, you know, remind yourself to undertake activities or make sure your current activities give you the opportunity to demonstrate that and accumulate the evidence. So be pragmatic as well. But really, I think being able to point to grants, point to a team you've built up and so on, all of that speaks to research leadership. But it's really the thought leadership and so on that I think most people tend to forget a bit. And that's why I was saying it's good to write reviews that are highly accessible, that really take your work and put it in the light of what's already known and show how together that really is a bit of a step change in thinking and so on. And if you do a good enough job of that, it'll be highly cited, very highly cited, and if you're lucky, it'll be the subject to a commentary and so on. And don't be afraid to recommend to editors and so on that someone could write a commentary. So I'll stop there and welcome any questions. Yeah.
I've got a question about peer review.
Yeah.
Would you recommend us including, if we have it, reviewers' reports of a journal or a book?
Yeah, it's a tricky thing. You don't have a huge amount of space. If it was, you know, that's why I like to say to people, if you've got a commentary that was published in a journal or somewhere, that's usually the better way to go. You know, if the publication has appeared in a high quality journal, that says obviously the referees thought it was really good. If you were awarded a project grant, that means the reviewers thought what you proposed and your track record and your capacity to deliver was really good. So I'm not that keen on it, but you know, it's I don't want to dismiss it out of hand. I have seen people do it, but I think you want to talk about, I've published this in one of the best journals, I was awarded something from a highly competitive scheme. I'd do that first. Yeah.
You might also need to be careful, the journal may not give you permission.
Oh, that's interesting. Yep. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I've also got a question about in-press publications.
Yep. Yep.
What are they typical evidence? What is the typical evidence that the panel would look at in-press publications? So you did the publication aid.
Oh, yes. Well, usually you have the identifier. You know, there's that unique identifier and that's fine. It's whatever is acceptable for ARC and NHMRC and, yeah, you know, it's that unique.
DOI.
Yeah, DOI, yep. And that's fine because everyone, I mean, that's on record.
Yep.
So there's no argument about it. But make sure that it is actually published. It's really important now with ARC and NHMRC because they're getting very technical, quite rightly, I think. Any other questions? Okay. Well, good luck.
So thanks for having me here today. Now, don't hesitate to interrupt with any questions if you have. And of course, I think we'll have time. I hope we'll have time at the end. So a brief overview of my background as it is relevant to this application. So I got my Bachelor of Computer Engineering with honours in 2005. I then finished my PhD in 2011 in a very small group, and I'm saying this because this matters with respect to the number of publications and so on. So in a small research group where basically only myself and my supervisor were working on stuff. I then got an associate lecturer position here at the University of Adelaide, and it was a contract for 2 years in 2011, in mid-2011. And I applied for promotion in 2013 and got it as a lecturer. And it was also then that my contract got changed from a two-year contract to a permanent position. In 2014, I applied for an associate dean position within the faculty, and I became the associate dean for diversity and inclusion for the faculty. ECMS stands for Engineering Computer and Mathematical Sciences. And I was on maternity leave in at the beginning of 2016 for about 4 or 5 months. And this is important again because, and the second part is also important, and I've been sleep deprived ever since. My son is very cute and awesome, but I think he also works for the KGB. But this matters because these issues made me actually be very organized, and this will explain also the diagram in the next slide. And I applied for promotion while I think I was just out of maternity leave, and I applied for promotion and got it to senior lecturer, and here I am. So this is basically the flowchart of my promotion sort of application. My first question was whether I apply for this, and I sort of had a think about it. Initially, I think in 2015, I also had a very vague think about it, and I talked to my head of school. And they weren't very keen on suggesting that I apply for a promotion. Now, I think the reason why this happened, I didn't apply, but the reason why this happened was because when I did go to the head of school, I sort of like went, oh, do you think I should apply for promotion? Sort of like a butterfly coming in a pretty garden. Whereas in 2016, when I went to talk to my head of school, and this is point two, I had a bullet point list of all the things that defined my awesomeness. And when I showed, and nothing, not much had changed between 2015 and 2016. But when I showed this bullet point list to my head of school, they were able to say, oh, all right, well, okay, you fit this, you're really good. All right, done. I'm going to support you for your application. After I got my head of school support, I contacted my referees really, really early. So that was, I think, right about now, more or less. Then I started the process of writing. Which took a while, and I'll talk about it later. And then I sent it for feedback to everybody that I could think of, polished the application, reminded referees, and hunted them down to send the referee letter, not really, but close enough, and then I submitted. So when I thought about whether I applied, I basically looked at the four things that are looked at and considered, and I did a bullet point list, but not of my overall awesomeness per se, but of the evidence that I had to support that. So, and this is in terms of numbers, in terms of, you know, any sort of like fantastic self-commentary, if anything, but really just focused on the evidence. What evidence did I have that whatever it was that I did had any impact, was any, you know, was awesome, or was of any use to anybody? So let's say I did... I organized a workshop for students, let's say, looking at improving their coding skills. And evidence for that, for me, was the number of students that came to the workshop, and also the number of students that then told me that they had applied for a job position or something like that. So it was really important for me to have this evidence when I was talking to the head of school, but also when I was writing my application later. So for teaching, and you've heard, you know, I had CELTS, I had an awards list, I had failure rates in the courses that I designed or redesigned, ideally improving failure rates. The number and the types of courses that either I designed or developed or co-designed and so on. The number of students supervised, whether they were honors, masters or PhDs, as well as and this was really boring for me to write, but as well as what kind of grades did they get, if any, for their honors? Did they get any commendations for their thesis? Was there anything else measurable with respect to this? For research, obviously papers, the number of citations and the H index, computer science uses Google Scholar, so I use the H index on Google Scholar, as well as any money. And this was basically any Cat Fund grants or any other industry contracts that I was part of. Now in my case, I didn't have any, and I still don't have any ARC grants, but I had a lot of industry money, which made me confident that it was good enough. In terms of admin, I had all the committees that I was part of, as well as my role on those committees, any programs developed, any initiatives, and this includes here anything that I did within the school, within the faculty, or within the university. And for service, this basically is your program committees. If you're editor of any journal, any outreach community events that you help organize, so open day, going to schools, and so on. So that was basically about it in terms of the bullet point. But I also talked to the head of school, to my head of school, as well as any friends or colleagues that I could find, basically. But only after I made this bullet point list, because then I knew what I was talking about. When I went to the head of school to discuss my my application, I had the bullet point list, but I also wanted to discuss, assuming that they were supportive, which they were, I also wanted to discuss the weighings of each of the elements. And this is an updated one. I think it has changed from last year, but basically for me it was a question of, did I have enough evidence to show research awesomeness at 60%, and if not, what was the associated weighting that I was going to put for research? How was I going to balance the administration and the teaching evidence that I had, as well as was there anything to do with the professional activity that I could add there that would be really awesome and beyond the 10% that you have there? And I did this because, and this, and together with the bullet point list, basically informed how I was going to write my application in terms of the number of pages. Can you tell that I'm an engineer? In terms of the number of pages that I assigned to each of the categories, as well as any sort of evidence that I provided. So for example, I think my professional activity in terms of the weighings was really small, probably it was just 10%, I cannot remember, but it had a really short space in the commentary that I developed. And the others were obviously a bit higher. So once I did this, I contacted my referees with are you willing to write a referee letter for me sort of email. And I contacted four. The reason why I contacted four is because I wanted to have, because you receive the referee letters, then you can pick the best one. Basically, that was my sneaky plan, and this is basically what I did. I contacted four of them. Two were international, one was an academic, and one was previously an academic and now in industry. And the other two were nationals. One was a head of school from Monash, and the other one was a professor, I think, from University of Sydney. Now, this, in the end, this really mattered. I got all four back. So I got all four letters back. And the most prestigious one that I thought would be was the international academic. But the international academic didn't have enough time to write my referee letter. And also her style was very, how should I put it? Her sentences were very, very short. So the letter, although it was awesome and it was glowing, it read like an AK-47. Running through I don't know, somewhere. Anyway, so I didn't pick her letter mainly because I didn't like the way it read. So in the end I picked the head of school from Monash because it was quite long and it was also quite glowing and it had lots of beautiful words which I approved of. So if they do accept, of course, I did send them their application. I think it was really 3 or 4 weeks before the actual deadline, and I told them that the deadline was 1 week before, such that I could have their letters back quickly, and so on. And of course, I did send them reminders as we were approaching the deadline. But really, I only needed them with the international academic. All right, so. The writing was quite a nasty process for me, mainly because I don't like to talk about stuff that I've done. So in the end, I read the requirements of what was supposed to be in there. So it's basically 25 pages overall, but it doesn't include your head of school report and it doesn't include your referee letters. It has to have a commentary on achievements over the last 5 years, as well as evidence of achievement. And this includes your publication list, a teaching portfolio, information on grant funding, PhD student supervision, etc. It also has to include a CV. And I think, and this is similar to how we do when we write grants, I looked at the formatting and what was allowed and what wasn't allowed, and I made a template and I used that whenever I was writing. And also for me, I didn't actually consider any special, I didn't consider any special circumstances, but I will when I'll go next for promotion. So if you've had interruptions due to, as you've heard all the reasons before, you have to submit, if you want to, you can submit a special circumstance application. However, that application has to be submitted before the actual promotion application is due. So it's not at the same time. You need to receive that first before you start, well, not really before you start writing, but definitely before you submit. So if you do have that, it's good to think about it in advance. All right, and there's also, and I loved this, because remember, sleep deprived and young baby, there's a checklist on the HR website that you can then check once you're going, you've gone through all of the bits and pieces. All right, so I also looked at some example applications. There are applications on the HR website which are absolutely brilliant. However, they might not, they weren't, in my case, they weren't from computer science. So I couldn't really, I could see some words and I could see how people talked about things and what their narrative was, but I didn't have anything from my discipline. So I asked for successful promotion applications from actually from my head of school and from two other colleagues, and I looked at those and I shamelessly used any sort of words that I thought were really good. So, you know, strategy, engagement, leadership, all of these things that, for me at least, didn't come naturally. Of course, the applications might look different across years and so on, and in my case, I had an application from 2008. It didn't have the exact same format and the exact same structure as the current ones, but at least I could reuse the words. All right, so for me, I had a 4-page CV, a CELT that covered 6 pages, because it was from 2 courses. I also included a CELT commentary, and in that commentary I had, basically the story is, I was terrible once at teaching, I learned from this being, there was evidence of me being terrible to some extent, so some sort of CELT question or some failure rate or whatever. So there was evidence of me being terrible, and I have improved, and this is how I have improved, and this is what I have done to address this. Ideally, and this is why I was talking about this, in my case, I also had evidence that there was an improvement from before to current. The teaching portfolio, in my case, it was 5 pages. It has to include as well, and this is what I forgot as I was writing it and had to rush to add it, it has to include PhD student supervision philosophy as well, because PhD students and, you know, the supervision of PhD students is classified under teaching. I had a publication list, about 3 pages, a grant list of 1 page, and then the commentary, which was 5 pages. And I started, I think, with the CV because it was the easiest one to write, mainly because all I had to do is put stuff in, which is what I did. So really, I used the CV to, in my second go, I used the CV to expand the narrative from my commentary. So when I was talking about something in the commentary, I also put it in the CV with additional numbers, or maybe if I didn't have the time there to talk about a particular project, I talked about it in the CV. So, you know, there's your, whatever it is that you have in your CV, your education, number of PhD students, and so on, but I also included, for example, in my case, I had a number of outreach projects that I didn't have the space to talk about in the commentary, so I expanded on those in the CV. All right, so For the teaching portfolio, I started with my teaching philosophy and what motivates me to teach. And for me, it was easy. This one was easy in the sense that I had really bad teachers when I was a university student, and that it really motivated me to improve. But then I broke it into sections. So I had teaching responsibilities where basically I listed all the courses that I taught as well as what my responsibilities were in those courses. So course coordinator, lecturer, and so on. I also briefly discussed any sort of methodologies or innovations that I did in lectures, tutorials, as well as in assessment and feedback. And the other section that I had was engaging students locally and worldwide. And that was the heading that I used. So for me, it was assessment and course design, job preparations, and I took part in building a MOOC, so I put that in as well. And then, of course, research supervision, and mine focused on getting PhD students job ready, et cetera, nationally, as well as internationally. It also included a lot of evidence as well. So I had evidence in the commentary, but also in the teaching portfolio. And in my case, I had pretty plots, which was one of these, basically showing the drop in course failure rates after I started redesigning a particular course. And it included CELT comments as well as the actual values of the CELT. I didn't put any CELT tables, mainly because I ran out of space in this commentary, but I've seen that they're very common in all the promotion applications. I did have a teaching award application, actually quite a lot, so I shamelessly, again, reused stuff from those because they were previously written, especially those that dealt with this particular plot as well as any other sort of numbers and commentaries. Now, for the commentary, because I had that bullet point list, I could easily transform it into text. And this sort of shows what I had in terms of the breakdown. So my teaching commentary was about 2 pages. The reason why I went for 2 pages is because I have, I think, a number of awards, which then sort of like they took the first part of the teaching discussion. The research in my case was much lower than all the others, mainly because while I had a high number of publications and H-index and so on, I didn't have any ARC funding. And I also had very few projects where I was lead in terms of the grant money. In my case, it was about 1%. Here, although I think it would have made a better, because the actual funding amount was very high, I was a bit apprehensive of putting a lot of emphasis on those. So I just emphasized the aspects where I was leading. Now, because I'm an associate dean for diversity and inclusion, I did a lot of things in my associate deanship, and these took out about 1.5 pages of the admin part of the commentary. And here I talked about any schemes that I developed, any programs, all the faculty committees that I convene, obviously my role in them, which is convener, as well as any participation in the university committees, what my role is in there, and so on and so forth. And I ran out of space for service, so then I just did a list of all the program committees and editors and all the other bits and pieces. I just dumped them in there. I put a bit of emphasis on community projects and outreach projects in my CV. All right, so for teaching, for me, I had a number of teaching awards. The way I talked about them was, in the beginning, I had a short paragraph describing my teaching awesomeness, and then I said, you know, the evidence of this are these number of awards, and they're all in bullet point list. Now, the reason why I did that, and I did this throughout the application as well, is because I wanted it to make it very easy for the committee to see. Now, I think I went to a workshop like this maybe 2 or 3 years ago, and one of the executive deans was talking about the role of the committee, and this helped me quite a lot. And what he said was basically that the role of the committee is to see and find evidence to promote you. They're not guarding the gates of heaven and not allowing you in. So because at the University of Adelaide, we're looking at merit-based promotions, not quota-based promotions. So because of this, throughout the application, I really tried to make it very easy for somebody to see and then talk about it in the committee meeting that you heard about. So this included bullet points, pretty plots, tables, and so on, such that people can see. Then I focused the commentary on teaching practices, student engagement, course and assessment design, and supervision. And I did have a narrative on journey at the beginning of the commentary, but I ran out of inspirational juices, so then I sort of just talked about the things that I was doing. And again, more numbers here. So here again, sales, failure rates, attendance rates, if you can get them for your courses. In my case, I had also forum views and forum discussion posts. So I had a course about 2 years ago that was really engaging students online, and I talked about that in terms of engagement, strategies for engagement, as well as, again, evidence. So that was the forum views as well as the discussion posts. And in here, I only used the best self commentary that I could find. So anything. And the way I did have that best self commentary is whenever I receive CELTs, if there's something really good in them, I keep them in a feel good folder. So I go there and check, because I think going through them again would just be terrible. I was short of time, needed to write it very quickly. In terms of the research, for me, I focused my commentary on leadership and collaboration, but also on the fact that I was doing, and I still am doing, a lot of interdisciplinary research. And I talked about the challenges. So again, here it was a journey and a narrative, but I also talked about the challenges of doing interdisciplinary research, namely that it takes a long time to establish partnerships, that they're difficult to fund, and basically that it takes a long time for people to actually see any tangible results. And again, I made it easy for the committee to see. Basically, all of these, so the PUBS, my H-index, discipline benchmarks, as well as the fact that in computer science, the publication venue of choice is conferences. Conferences are double-blind, peer-reviewed, and so on, and they're very similar to journals in other disciplines, but they're called conferences, because why not? All of these were at the beginning of the research commentary. I think they were italics and underlined, but I also focused on showing strategy and plans, because I think that what the committee wants to see, they also want to see that you're not going to get promoted and then say, okay, we're done, I'm not going to do anything more, I'm just going to plateau here. They want to see that you're going to take your work forward and that there's hope, let's say. I also summarized, and because I do a lot of interdisciplinary research, but I also work in a lot of groups, so I summarized all the groups, talking about my contribution to those groups, but also any strategies and measurable evidence-based outcomes for this. So in this case, it was the money, any publications, the visits that people made, any fellowships that I had, as well as in my case, because I employ software developers to do some of the things, the number of people that work for me. And for the admin, as I said before, I think the extra bit that I didn't talk about before was the fact that I also talked about the associate dean strategy. And most of the associate deans, when they do come into their deanship, either they have to develop a strategy from scratch, which is what I had to do, or they build upon an existing strategy, aligning it with the faculty or the university priorities. So I talked about that. And I also talked, where possible, about outcomes, if any. And here, my application, I think, wasn't as measurably strong, mainly because it's very hard with my role to measure change in culture. It's actually a bit impossible. But I talked about that as well. So then I had other soft metrics like students reported or things like that. Okay, and then I sent, once I was done with all of this, I sent it to everybody that I could think of. For the first on my list was my head of school. The second one was my executive dean. And I saw my executive dean every week, so it was okay for me to ask for that work on his behalf. But if you do meet your executive dean and if they know who you are, please send it to them. I think they'll be more than happy at least to have a quick glance and say, right, doesn't work, or works. I also sent it to my colleagues, and I made my husband read it as well, because why not? And I did this because it took them about three or four weeks to actually respond. Some responses were pretty very thorough, the ones from the head of school and the executive dean in particular. And they were very detailed, outlining several things where I wasn't doing a good job. And in my case, I had forgotten to talk about the PhD students completely. And I wasn't showing leadership and strategy in the research component. The good thing was that by the time they had actually responded, I could go and write again, because by the time I had finished writing, I was done. I never wanted to see the application ever again. But by the time they responded, I could yet again polish it. When I sent it to the heads of schools and the executive deans, I did a, because that's how the planets aligned and that's what the time frame was, I did a spell check and I sent it to the referees as well. So they didn't get to see the final draft, but what they saw was, I think, good enough. Okay, and I think that's it. They, they eventually responded, sent through four letters, I picked one, and then I added it to the thing. I think the only thing that is not on the slide and that you have to have a sneak peek at is the submission website application, because there are some things in there that are not evident with respect to how you can submit things. You can either, I think then, I don't know whether how it is now, you can either submit it as a full application or in parts. And the parts bit really confused me. And again, that might be, because of sleep deprivation. So here I was, at 11 p.m. before the deadline, trying to sort things out. So have a look and see. It's really clear if you take the time to actually read rather than pressing on the buttons as they show. All right, cool. Any questions? Thank you. Yes?
Good luck with your whole fleet, all glass, to be honest.
Yeah.
You've done everything you're planning in advance. Do you remember when you actually got the first draft done, was that in March?
Well, I had the head of school conversation about maybe a week after this, so after the equivalent workshop last year.
Yeah.
So then put, 4 weeks or so on that. Yeah, yeah. But because I really didn't like writing it, it was a experience that required a bit of alcohol afterwards. Not really, because, couldn't have alcohol. Dreams of alcohol. Because I didn't really like writing it, the bullet point list and the checklist really helped me, because I could go through each and everything and, write about it and then go back and do something else and so on. But it's just a personal thing. Yes?
Claudia, you talk about getting in touch with referees well in advance.
Yep.
And what they were saying before about referees, Jenny was saying, is that it doesn't have to be somebody that knows you personally.
Yep.
So then when you contact the referee out of the blue, what do you tell them? Because you haven't written your application yet.
So I had somebody like that, one of the profs. I just wrote to him and said, hello, I'm so-and-so, I attended your talk at blah, blah, blah. And you were talking then about supporting people for their application, right? Because he was. And then I said, well then, behold, I'm here. Would you mind writing a referee report for me? Here are what I did send through then, although I didn't have a draft, I said, here are the guidelines for the University of Adelaide promotions. Not the whole thing, because you like your referees. Don't send. I didn't think of sending him the entire document, but rather the bits that applied to a level B to C sort of promotion. And because he was Australian, he understood how these things work. And then I told him, you know, I'm going to send you, if you're okay. Once he was okay, I said, I'm going to send you this in blah weeks. And I made sure I stuck to that deadline as well, because I didn't want to appear flaky.
So the first letter is really introducing yourself.
Yeah.
And seeking a sort of the okay that,
yeah,
that person,
yeah,
would be prepared to do that.
Yeah.
And you've,
yeah,
told them what's expected.
Exactly. So I said, you know, you're going to have to write a maximum 2-page, because that's what the,
yes,
referee letter is. It's not really 2-page because it has to fit in all the bits and pieces of who they are and so on. You're going to have to write these parts, these are the headings, and this is what a level C academic is basically doing at this university. Would you be okay with? Well, but again, because I had 4 of them on my list, I had, you know, backups in case somebody didn't have the time, or, you know, the letter wasn't as I wanted it, and so on. Mind you, in the end, so I had this prof whose letter was absolutely brilliant, and he said, oh, I don't know this person, rah, rah, rah. I thought I was reading an associate professor application, but it's a level C. So that's what he wrote. And then I had the head of school from Monash who knew me and had published with me. And of course her letter was glowing and I didn't know what to do. So I picked the glowing one. Should I pick the other one? It would have been even more perfect. But yeah, I think that was for me the benefit of having more than one to choose from.
Did you actually tell them you
were
reviewed?
No, I told them no. I thanked them, and then once I got the response, I said, oh, thank you for your help, rah, rah, rah. I got promoted, etc. I'll see you soon in the case of those people that I knew.
Good afternoon, everybody. Isn't it great to hear the story from the perspective of a successful applicant? My name's Jane Welch. I'm currently the Associate Director of HR Advisory in HR. Lisa and Rebecca, you've already met this morning. I used to be the manager of workplace relations, so the process for promotion under the enterprise agreement is very familiar to me. This afternoon, Lisa and I will take the last 15 minutes to give you an outline of what it looks like under the enterprise agreement, to the requirements under the enterprise agreement, and how your application is drafted to be compliant with that. So we'll take about 15 minutes, and Lisa will cover off on how the application is processed online. So Claudia's helpful advice about how that looks from an applicant's perspective is very helpful. So again, Claudia has mentioned how she's put her application together, but these are the requirements under the enterprise agreement. So the page count can't be more than 25 pages, with the exception of teaching review program reports, which have been added as optional information that if you have them, you can also submit them and they won't go towards the 25 pages. So the only thing that has a particular page limit is the curriculum vitae, which can't be more than 6 pages, but the rest of the... this one here. With a limit of 6 pages, but the commentary and the evidence of achievement that you can demonstrate over the last 5 years makes up the balance of those 25 pages. So the evaluation of teaching for 2 semesters within the last 3 years, including the evidence of CELTs and other quantifiable assessments. So the CELT data is in the original output and doesn't include student comments. The teaching portfolio that can't be more than 6 pages. I don't need to read out what you can read yourselves, but a publication list, evidence of the quality of the publications, and grant funding achievements, and the PhD students, which Claudia mentioned before, is also a component of the application as specified in the enterprise agreement. So these are the referee documents that are required. It depends on the level that you are applying for promotion at as to what the referee requirements are. So in relation to level B, you can choose either an internal or external referee. For level C, that is
external only.
In each case, the application is submitted with a head of school report. The relationship you have with the head of school is very important, not only for the head of school report,
but also for the role the head of school has to play in soundboarding with you the strengths that you want to emphasise in your application when it comes to weightings. When it comes to level D and E, the application is supported by external assessors who are, for level D, have to be, one of them has to be from a group of eight, and for level E, one of the assessors needs to be from an international university. The assessors are arranged through HR as opposed to the referee reports, which are sourced by the applicant themselves. There is some flexibility if in the space of the assessor, you're in a field of study that makes it more difficult to comply with this, and there's an ability for the DVCA to, sorry, I wrote that down on my own, the DVCA to come to an arrangement to accommodate the particular circumstances you're in. But otherwise, these are the requirements as spelt out in the enterprise agreement. If there are title holders in the room, there is a process for applying for promotion as a title holder. Level B, C or D is the request is made by way of the Executive Dean at the time of either the conferral of the title or the renewal of the title. In the case of Level D, the Level E, there's a process under the enterprise under the promotions procedure. There's an exception if you're wanting to apply outside that cycle, outside the conferral or the natural renewal of a title, but that's at the discretion of the Executive Dean. Now, in relation to academic focus areas, you'll know that the promotions procedure refers to these five areas of academic focus. The significance here is for the weight that you can apply to your application to emphasise for the committee the particular area that you regard as the strength of your application. So it's an opportunity for you to document that. It means that if there's a clear and equitable process for all applications so that everyone's referring to the particular areas that they regard as favourable to their application. And what we will now talk about is how the weightings apply. So the five focus areas are the teaching and research academic and education specialist workload. If you've been appointed into one of those roles, which under the enterprise agreement has a teaching allocation of up to 90%. A scholarly teaching fellow, so a fixed term category there of A and B academics. The scholarly teaching fellow has a teaching component of 75%. It's worth pointing out to you, if you don't already know, that once a person holding a scholarly teaching fellow contract is promoted, then they're no longer a scholarly teaching fellow and they fall into the workload allocation under the enterprise agreement generally. Then there are the research areas of either a research-focused academic with a high research workload or the specific category of research-only grant-funded applications. This is the weighting schedule. There's a special category for special consideration. So staff members who have had their academic career interrupted by personal circumstances or extenuating circumstances sits outside this weighting, these weighting categories. But these are the five areas of focus and the respective weightings that you can apportion to your own application. So this is where you are the person who will know best how to weight your application. When you speak to your head of school, that's your opportunity to test with the head of school whether they also agree that that's your particular area of focus. In the case of education specialists and research-focused academics, they can weight their application up to 90% in favour of either teaching or research. In relation to the research-only grant funded, there's a 97% weighting for research in that category. The minimum levels there of 1%, it's a weighting, it's not a workload, it's a weighting, and it can look a little silly, but the requirement under the procedure is that each of these areas must be addressed in your application. So there's not an option of saying nothing in relation to these, but you can weight what you say at the minimum of 1% and put all your weight into the research there for the research only grant funded. The teaching and research academic workload is probably the most common application that we'll see, and in those cases you can look at the weight you want to attach to that by either going to a maximum of 60% for teaching and research or a maximum of 40% for administration or professional activity. I am reminded by Lisa that it commonly is the case that applications come in that don't add up to 100%. So I'm just sharing with you that if you can follow this, yes, just double check that you've done your numbers and it does actually get to 100%, not less than or more than that. So this is a scoring guide. Very simply, the applications will be scored by the committee members who form the promotions committee. They will not know how you've weighted your application. They will score, having considered the application individually, on this scale. So with a 1 to 2 being a weak case that falls very short of promotion.
Yes.
So this is the scoring guide that the committee work to when they're assessing the applications.
Mm-hmm. I didn't quite get that. The question was, the question at the front was
whether the committee will know what category of focus area that you've nominated in as your
education specialist.
Yes, okay. And they will know that.
All right,
they won't know within that category the weight that you've given the respective areas of endeavour.
They will or they won't?
Will not.
No.
Okay. No.
Do you get a score for each of the areas, like the teaching, research,
admin? Mm. Yeah. Maybe the next slide, I'll just... No, this slide will tell you how this works. And then I have three slides that give you a bit of a comparison. It's the same academic, but through three different lenses. So we'll perhaps come to that later. This is the process for the committee members. They'll score the application without knowing how you've weighted the focus areas. HR applies the weightings to the score by applying an arithmetical formula. The weighted score will be used to score the applicant at the end of the day to determine the outcome of the application. If that score is 8 or above, if it's above 8, the application is deemed promotable. If it's less than 8, more than 7, the committee will further moderate the application. So it won't... There will be a further discussion amongst the committee members. If the score is less than 7, the application is deemed not promotable. So the committee itself, the promotable score comes from a committee outcome where the majority of the committee members have all scored the applicant as 8 and above. I can show you that through here, which is... So these are three slides which just show different weightings for the same Level C promotion. A committee of 5 members, committee number one scores each across the 4 areas. The individual weighted average score has had the weightings applied to it to have 8.2, and at the end of that process, the 8.1 is the weighted overall average score. It's above 8, so the applicant is promotable. In this case, they are a teaching research academic. They've recognised that teaching is their strength. So when the committee members all rated and scored this applicant at 8 or above, then the weighting has worked in their favour because they've realistically recognised that teaching is their strength. In this case, administration has been weighted as the strength of the applicant. They would have been better back here, but it hasn't dropped them below 7. At 7.9, the committee will moderate the application, go back and have another look before they determine whether the applicant is to be promoted. And the last example has, this one has different scores. So this applicant is not promotable. They've not only scored below 6.8, but there aren't three committee members who've ever considered this applicant to be an 8 or above. And in this case, yeah, they've probably done, it's probably a reflection of the strength, yeah. So that's what the committee does. That applicant would not be successful. I'm happy to stop and take questions there. I'm about to hand over, and I'm conscious of the time, that Lisa is going to walk through how the process looks to you online, which I suspect is a very important thing to do. So I'll be happy to take questions.
Can I just quickly ask where the committee members come from?
So for level B and C, the convener... Sorry, is that one? Yeah, thanks. The convener of the committee is generally the exec dean of that faculty, and the other committee members are nominated by the exec dean, so they might be heads of schools, discipline heads within that faculty. So it's for level B and C.
Thank you.
Yeah, we put the committee membership lists on the website, so you will know who's on your committee.
Yeah.
It won't be before you put in application, no, generally. It could be up before the closing date. They're just being confirmed at the moment and locked in now, so hopefully. So on the Academic Promotions webpage, this is what it will look like to apply. So you go to your level, this is level B highlighted, and you have these buttons available. They'll only be available when the call's gone out and the campaign's live to apply. So also on the Academic Promotions page, we've got the schedule for the year, checklist, how to download the CELTs, etc. And the committee membership will also be on there under the overview tab when that's confirmed. So when you click on apply now, that will take you through to the online application process, which is actually used for recruitment at the Adelaide University. It's the same system, but we use it for the promotions applications. Once you've put in your ID and password, you can save and exit at any time. And if you want to go back in, just go back in as an existing applicant, just put your password in, you can just continue where. So you don't have to complete it all the first time you go in. So this will take you, as I said, through to register with your email address. And it's really just steps you through step by step, entering your details, pretty straightforward. Levels, a date of last promotion, etc. All this information is just used for our benefit. And then it'll take you through to the waitings table that have been discussed quite length today. So you just, the bottom here is just cut off, enter your waitings manually for each of those categories according to which focus area you're applying under. And then I think this is the bit, Claudia, that you said was a bit confusing. So you can complete your application as one document and upload the whole document as one, or you can choose to upload individually with your commentary, which we now have a template for. It's just addressing the four headings, the evidence as one document, CV. I think, like Claudia said, if you read through it, it is actually quite self-explanatory. But it's just taking the time just to make sure. And you can always send me an email or phone me, and I can just check through to make sure everything's there before you submit it if you're a bit unsure. And the special consideration form too also gets uploaded at this point once that's been signed by the DVCA. And then it takes you to the final page of submission. So before you get to this page, you can save and exit at any point, like I said. But once you've submitted, then there's no going back in to change anything. That's submitted to me. So, yeah, if you have any questions, just give me a call or email me and I can step you through anything that does seems a bit confusing there. Is there any questions? Yeah.
Lisa, can I say, so if we put in some weightings at the beginning and that by the time we get back to our application, can we go back and
change? Yeah, you can change that. Yeah, you can just go back in. Yeah, as long as you haven't pressed the submission button, you can change anything. Yeah, but have a discussion with your head as well around those weightings. Sorry.
This is with this application, so the reference reports and the head of schools report, would that be included in this?
Yes, you upload those as well, yeah. So you upload those yourself.
Is that 25 pages?
No. So the referee reports and head of school report are not included in that page count, but the CELTs are. So
you have to decide really what information you put
forward. Yeah. So the CELTs you have to cover two semesters over the last 3 years. Yeah. And a little cheats way, I guess, is that you can put two CELTs onto one page landscape just to give you a bit more space. I do recommend that you do that if you're running out of space. Yeah. Sorry.
With special consideration, is it still that you can only put in two areas?
Yeah, you can address only two if that's what you wish to do, or you can still address all four, but the committee will take into account your special situation circumstances, and you can extend that 5-year period for the amount of career interruption you've had on a 1-to-1 ratio. But that goes by your exec dean, I think, then approved by or not approved by Professor Cuesta as the DVCA. And that has to be submitted with your application, so can't be submitted after, it has to be approved prior.
Does that take very
long? No, she's really, really quite quick at responding to those, yeah. But obviously give a bit of notice, don't do it the day before the applications close, yeah. Yeah.
Is that a sort of flexible time frame or strictly?
If you're not,
to 17 or
yeah, it's pretty strict. Yeah, to the date. So it's 5 years prior to the date of application.
Yeah.
So which is the closing date? Yeah. Yeah. So 22nd of May, I think, is closing date. So 5 years prior to that. I mean, I don't think they'll look at a day or two, but yeah. Sorry, did you?
So for the focus areas, how do I, let's say, in the last 5 years, half of that time, I did the research on it, it's 100% research, and then I just get to like 40-40 for research and teaching.
Yeah, so it will be what the last 5 years mainly reflects, because that's where you're going to be providing the evidence. So you'll need to have a conversation with your head of school and get some advice on where they feel that which category will suit you best.
So that's the mutual agreement with the head of school.
It's your decision ultimately, but it will, because they're more familiar with your work as well, so have that discussion.
Okay.
And work out what focus area is going to suit you best for the last 5 years, because that's where you'll be providing your evidence.
Okay, so that's not restricted by my current role, right?
It's
not restricted by my current role?
No. Okay. No, you're evidencing the previous 5 years, so. Yeah. Anybody else? I need to wrap up, I think. And if you do have any questions, please feel free to email me or just give me a phone call. And if I can't answer them straight away, I will get back to you within a few days. So thank you for coming.